Is it? Could it be? Dueling talk show hosts?
Or a symbolic rendering of the pitched battle that goes on between Phil and me in preparation for this show?
No, in fact, it's a sample of work you get to see at the Minnesota Electronic Theater and on Artifacts coming up next. Hello, I'm Phil Lindsay.
And I'm Janet Zahn.
And this is Artifacts, the show in which we talk about the arts and related issues here on City Cable 34.
We've got a great program lined up, including a preview of the 5th Annual Minnesota Electronic Theater.
And the big 7-state regional theater conference coming up in October, featuring workshops, plays, and a keynote address by John Kalaki.
Phil also goes on location for a look at the Minnesota Artists Exhibition Program.
And Susan Gross will be here with me to talk about an upcoming art exhibit at Dayton's called Girls and Girlhood, A Perilous Path.
And now, first up, a stunning display of computer animation from one of the electronic theater exhibitors. That was from the demo reel of Windlight Studios, one of Minneapolis's newest animation, computer animation companies. And with us from Windlight is Susan Van Burrow. Welcome, Susan.
Thank you.
I'd also like to welcome Bruce Pukema. Bruce is the animated animator who did those wonderful sword fighting skeletons at the beginning of the show. And Bruce is with Ronin Animation. Welcome. And over there in the beautiful green shirt is Stan Bissinger. Stan is the president of Seagraph, who is doing the event with my office called the Minnesota Electronic Theater for the 5th year this year. Mm-hmm. But before we go any further and before people lose those wonderful images, Susan, tell us a little bit about Windlight Studios and what we saw. And
Windlight Studios is about a year and a half old. It was started with 8 people. We're now up to 13 or 14, and we're focusing on doing character animation using computer graphics and headed towards doing longer format pieces, not necessarily 30-second commercials, but interactive pieces, new media pieces, CD-ROM, television series, feature films, that direction.
What do you do there?
I'm an animator. Sometimes I play a technical person. Sometimes I direct.
Mm-hmm. Well, welcome to the show. And welcome to Minneapolis. You're new to Minneapolis as
yes.
well. Bruce, you've been participating in the Electronic Theater. This will be your 2nd year.
Yes, it was.
As a participant, maybe you could give people an idea what they can expect to see and what your expectations are for the show.
Being the 2nd year, somewhat familiar with it, electronic theater is kind of a composite of everything that's going on in terms of broadcast electronically in this area of the Twin Cities, and it's a good opportunity for anybody to find out what the other people in the business are doing. For myself, I don't get out a lot. It's probably a good reason for that. And I don't know who the players are, but this is a good idea so that you can see what the other people are doing on the reels and meet some of the people who are actually doing it. It's very handy in that respect.
Yeah, it is kind of fun. It's just like an art exhibit, essentially, is what we're doing here and showing some work. Mm-hmm. Stan, from Seagraph's perspective, what's your interest in doing a show like the Electronic Theater?
Well, first of all, I can say that Seagraph is a acronym for Special Interest Group in Computer Graphics, and it is a part of ACM, which is the Association for Computing Machinery. So anything related to computer graphics or computers is actually part of ACM does. And then SIGGRAPH is more focused on the computer graphics industry. And as I've been told, it is the largest component of ACM and probably one of the most popular because obviously computer graphics is across the nation becoming very popular. At the local or at the national level, SIGGRAPH has a very an incredible show. The last one was in Orlando, Florida, and a huge convention, and the probably the premier event of these shows is the Electronic Theater, where the national producers of animation kind of show their most recent wares as sort of the coming out event for animation. And we're trying to recreate that passion and that deliverance of quality animation here in Minneapolis. And this is sort of our version of the electronic theater on the national level.
Do you think that people will see work at this, you know, that's similar in style and, you know, at a similar level here in Minnesota as they would see at a national conference?
Well, similar if you mean that some of the pieces that were in the national level will be in the show. Mm-hmm. And in to expand out to the local producers that do produce that produce at that level, you bet it's going to be as good, if maybe not better, than the national level. Mm-hmm. But no, all seriousness aside, it's going to be a lot of fun too. It's going to be a casual event at the Fine Line, and it's just going to be fun for people, and it's going to be a tremendous interaction, not only between people that produce, but also people that want to buy this product as well for their own needs.
Yeah. Now, we've been doing the event for 5 years. This is the fifth annual. And I'd like you all to step back about 5 years. I know we've seen some dramatic changes in this industry, you know, both again on a national level, but locally as well. And I'm just wondering what some of those the most significant changes have been. Bruce, maybe you as an artist and as a person who's working with the machines, what kinds of changes have you seen?
Well, I'd say in 5 years, in terms of this marketplace, in terms of computer animation, there's a lot more competition, which usually is in response to a need. Also, the software is becoming a lot more transparent in that artists can use it. Somebody as inept technically as I am can get away with it. Mm-hmm. And I think we've made a lot of really tremendous leaps in terms of the technology, your memory, your speed. Eventually, it's like you've got a catalog that can be filled, but the more room you've got, you always fill it up. Mm-hmm. And so you always need more speed, more memory. Mm-hmm. And that seems to be a large change that's happened in this area in particular.
From the stuff that you've been working on, Susan, over the years, how have things changed?
I would say the most dramatic change for me has been the motion capture software. I was trying to do character animation 10 or 12 years ago when it was all hand rotating every joint, you know, this finger, and you rotate it a little in this one. And now we do a lot, at Windlight, we do a lot of our motion using a motion capture suit, which you probably saw some clips of people with kind of cords coming off of them. And those are actually sensors. There's a magnetic field produced in those sensors, determine the orientation and the location in space of the joint. And then we go back and calculate for a character with different length limbs, where would that put the character so that as an actor moves in a certain direction, we can see the character on the screen moving. And then we go back, clean it up, add ears flapping, tails wagging, lip sync, eye motion, scarfs flying, whatever.
Does that save you a lot of time?
Yeah, it saves a tremendous amount of time because it gives you the basics. It blocks it out when the arm does this, the elbow does that, and it starts to get, then you go in and actually manipulate things from there, but it gives you 80% of the motion.
Mm-hmm. Does that make your job more enjoyable?
It does, because then you're directing. We want you to stand up and jump and turn and do this rather than hand animating all of the rotations to get them to get the characters into the position. Mm-hmm. It's a lot more like live action.
Yeah.
In that you can discuss things at a close to real time level rather than spending hours and hours and hours rotating joints.
We have another clip to show, and this is another piece that Bruce did.
Speaking of rotating joints.
There you have it.
all eight legs.
You know what I'm talking about.
Tell us, Bruce, this is a spot for Coca-Cola. Is there anything that you'd like to introduce as before we roll it?
Well, we got this through RealWorks, a traditional animation house here in town. And we tried to achieve a look that got rid of some of the computer slickness, maybe that's why they asked me to do it, out of the animation, so that it had you had that 3D presence, but with a kind of a 2D feel to it. And it was an experience for me. I'd not done, walking around with two limbs is enough trouble, but eight is another ball game entirely, but luckily we pulled it off.
So this is an example of something you did not use this.
No. Well, this is the old-fashioned way.
The old-fashioned way. Well, let's see
it.
Let's take a look.
Good. The genuine Coca-Cola bottle, preferred by everyone.
This isn't real time.
And that was Coca-Cola, the old-fashioned way.
Yeah.
How long did it take?
The old-fashioned bottle.
How long did it take you to do that?
Boy, it all gets to be a cloud after a while. we probably scripted the little devil in 3 weeks, but you've got to stop, do a test, send it out to the client. Mm-hmm. They get to, you know, yeah. give the benediction, you get it back. You send it back mm-hmm. out and pray.
and hope.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It might have been a 6-week contract on the whole thing, but mm-hmm. in terms of the basic scripting, might have been done in 3, mm-hmm. a little bit more.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was a nice piece.
Thank you.
And again, I just want to emphasize to both of you that I'm very impressed with the work you're doing. I think that's part of the reason that my office is involved with this show, because Minneapolis has so many strengths in this area, I think, and people don't get an opportunity to see it. Oftentimes the spots are running in other markets, or there's just not a venue for you folks, and that's what part of the reason that we do this event is so that people can get to see what you're doing, the great stuff that you're doing. Stan, in addition to being president of SIGGRAPH, you also work at the School of Communication Arts.
Right.
You're working with students who are doing this kind of thing.
Yes, all my students aspire to be Bruce and Susan.
Yeah, yeah.
Drive the town.
And the thing is that the tendency for these two, I know them well enough to know that they're very modest and self-effacing sometimes, but what they do is represents incredible patience and time and a lifetime of experience. And I enjoy having a chance to have interaction with them. It's nice for them to be able to, you know, Bruce has been over and Susan has been over to the school and sort of had a chance to do some mm-hmm. direction and guidance for them too. So it's a good relationship, I think.
Do either of you have any advice for Stan students? No.
I actually was mm-hmm. a professor mm-hmm. up till about 6 months ago, and yeah. so I have loads and loads of advice, and mostly keep at it.
Mm-hmm. Keep rolling.
Yeah, that would be it. And I think also, if at all possible, it seems like the tide is turning here, where if you can start picking up some basic art education, it's going to be a real big help. That's mm-hmm. not to say it doesn't exist now, but mm-hmm. the day of the techno individual just getting up and doing electronic smiley faces is kind of over. You have to bring a lot more to the dance, and I think that would serve them in real good stead mm-hmm. for employability.
Mm-hmm. One of the other new trends is that it's no longer a generalist's type of job. It used to be that one person would do everything, and now it's much more one person might be a color and lighting expert, someone else might build models, another person would do motion, mm-hmm. someone else would actually technically direct the piece.
Mm-hmm. Good things to know. Mm-hmm. Well, and I think we also need to give folks the details of this wonderful event that's coming up. It is on Wednesday, November 2nd, that's the first Wednesday in November, from 5 to 8 p.m. at the Fine Line Music Cafe, downtown Minneapolis. It's free. Got to take this opportunity. It doesn't cost you a thing. For more information, you can call 673-2947. And besides Susan and Bruce, there will be a number of other companies participating, including Ad Tech Animation, Video Design, Houghton Daily Monson Gunchen, or HDMG, IVL, Jenton and Video, Lamb and Company, and TeleEdit. And thanks, everybody, for being here. It was fun.
Thank you.
And
thank
I look
you.
Forward to seeing you in a month at the show. Mm-hmm. It should be a good time. And we will be right back with Phil's visit to the Minnesota Artists Exhibition Program right after this.
Now, that was a little PSA that was done right here by our City Cable 34 staff. They did a real nice job there to celebrate National Arts and Humanities Month. You may have seen some national pieces that were done to celebrate that month, but we weren't going to be outdone here at City Cable 34. Well, in our next segment, we're going to take a look on location at the Minnesota Artist Exhibition Program at the Minneapolis Institute of Arts. We're going to meet a couple of artists who have a nice and rather fun show there, Brian Frink and Gary Erickson, and Stuart Turnquist, who's the director of that. So let's head out and take a look at the Institute of Arts, the Minnesota Artist Exhibition Program. We're here at the Minneapolis Institute of Arts, an encyclopedic museum, which of course has quite a few collections, a lot of galleries. In fact, this winter they're undergoing quite a bit of renovation to expand some of the space and open up some of the new renovations from the 70s. One of the programs in here is the Minnesota Artists Exhibition Program. And thanks to Stuart Turnquist, who coordinates that program, we've been invited inside to take a look at some of the art and meet a couple of the artists who are in the show that's up right now. Let's go on inside and take a look. Well, we are now in the offices of the coordinator of the Minnesota Artist Exhibition Program, Stuart Turnquist, which, as you can see over my shoulder and past Stuart, is quite an eclectic space in itself. Stuart, thanks for helping get us in here to this current exhibition.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Can you tell us a little bit about what the Minnesota Artist Exhibition Program is, its history, and why it's here at the Institute of Arts?
Yeah, I'd be glad to. As the name suggests, Minnesota Artist Exhibition Program, we exhibit the works of Minnesota artists. And the program is part of the Minneapolis Institute of Arts, and it was started in 1975. And the program was conceived by artists that at that time, there were quite a number of artists that had decided that they weren't going to go to the East Coast, they weren't going to go to the West Coast, they weren't going south, they weren't going north, they were going to stay here. And staying here meant that they were not going to be able to sustain themselves, get a livelihood out of being artists. But it didn't mean that they were going to stop making art. And looking around, it occurred to them that what they really needed was a friendly and professional exhibition space. So the program was conceived by artists who then approached the museum, and it took about 6 months of negotiating with people within the museum, and finally they hit an agreement to give a curatorial department in the museum to the local, to the Minnesota artists, and that's how the program was born.
Well, we're up in the new space for the Minnesota Artist Exhibition Program, which we'll be talking about a little bit later in this segment. But I'm here with two of the artists at the Minnesota Artist Exhibition Program show that's up currently at the Institute of Arts. We've got Brian Frink and Gary Erickson. Gentlemen, you've collaborated on a show here that is one of the more colorful and I find kind of fun things here. How did you come together to do this?
Well, we were about a year and a half ago, Gary and I had submitted different proposals, and the committee that creates these exhibitions saw our work in separate proposals, and the suggestion was made that we show together based on that. And they saw some formal relationships to that our work had some philosophical similarities.
Well, and that's something I noticed right away, too. Gary, you've got some very interesting pieces, two of which happen to be right here in front of us. Can you talk a little bit about what we're looking at?
Well, the two pieces here are from the last year and a half. The work I have in the show is within the last 2 years, actually. And these pieces come from my feelings and inspiration from Latin salsa music. So it's actually not the salsa eating salsa, it's the dancing salsa. But I try to capture that energy and vitality and animation of both organic forms and also through what I feel through interpreting this music into my life, and also dancing, which some of the other pieces reflect a little bit more.
Yeah, I noticed a lot of kinetic energy in what you do. And Brian, right behind us is a piece of yours. Do you want to talk a little bit about what we're seeing here?
Well, this painting's called A Constellation in Her Ear, and it's really kind of a painting about my wife's earrings. She would come into my studio. I mean, it sounds kind of goofy, but she'd come into my studio, and I'd see, she always has different earrings on, I'd see one, and I would literally paint the earring, the particular shape, and of course then modify it, you know, in many ways, and manipulate and play around with it. So that's kind of where the painting comes from. It also has to do with a Moreau exhibition I saw about a year ago. He had a series of drawings called the Constellation series that I was really inspired by. So there's kind of a combination of personal things, you know, just my wife walking in my studio, and historical things.
Well, and I don't think we've mentioned the name of the show is?
Dancing Between the Known and the Magical, my cue card.
At least it's up on the wall.
Yeah, right.
Well, gentlemen, let's take a look at some more pieces here that are in the show.
The imagery in this particular painting is not quite as directed as some of my other ones, so it's kind of I suppose it's a religious painting. I mean, I was thinking about that whole thing about Jesus walking on the water, and I like water. I obviously use it in my drawings, and I'm always out in a canoe or a boat or something, and so I was just kind of thinking about jumping on the water, this one, you know, like some image of just running across the water. So,
and again, I get
exaltation,
I get a kinetic feeling from this as well.
Yeah, that's something that's real important in my work, and that's another similarity that both I and Gary have, is that we both believe in a real sense of animation in our work, like creating work that has a kind of a life force and an animate quality seems to be our one of our most important goals. And I think that's really, there's almost a sense of magic created in that kind of thing when a static object, either a sculpture or a painting, defies its physicality and becomes something that literally appears to move. It's based on an illusion, of course, but it's very magical.
Well, Gary, this looks like a lot of fun.
Yeah, this is one of my favorite pieces because it's very site-specific. When I saw the space and got the floor plan, I wanted to work within this window alcove and create a piece that really utilizes the natural light. Mm-hmm. And it goes back to the pedestals and
right.
Specific lighting. But there's so much natural light, and the carving lines really catches the light, and then also the piercing of the holes through the piece. As we were setting up, the light would change and shift, and this piece was ever evolving. I really like that sense of eternity and endlessness to the piece, that it was always a different piece to me every time I looked at it.
Well, let's take a look at what we've got here. Now, this struck me when I came into the gallery here, a lot of some real playful feelings come on these pieces.
Mm-hmm. They have that sense of playfulness of the interpretations can be balls. People have been saying bowling balls too, which is kind of funny.
Well, I understand that a child actually ended up playing a little bocce with one.
Yes,
of these.
they were sitting on top of it, rocking back and forth. Which, in one sense, of course, in a museum you can't touch it, but in the other sense, the tactileness of clay, they are very much meant. I don't mind people touching the work because I know they're pretty indestructible. But yet, you obviously don't want it damaged either. But there was a young child that was sitting and rocking on top of it. But these pieces have been very new for me because, unlike the other ones where I built with clay and it was an additive process, these were actually made out of a mold and creating a sphere and then carving back into it. So it's subtractive, which has been a really nice, refreshing change for me to try to get that same sense of animation and motion, but coming from subtracting from a form instead of adding. So I just created as many spheres as I could and then tried to look for the relationship between them to create this installation and kind of the randomness of just shaking them up and rolling them out on the floor, and that's where they land. And there's 1,001 possibilities for these, but every day I could come and change them a little bit. But also the way that people kind of interact and walk around them is really nice too. It's kind of, they're familiar with them, they take it for granted, which kind of breaks some of the stigma of a museum too, that it's precious, you can't touch.
Well, gentlemen, it's really been a pleasure to see your work and to get to know you guys a little bit better. A couple quick questions. What's next for you?
Well, I'm just back in my studio working, you know, on some new paintings, and I don't have anything scheduled right now, but I do need some time to just get some work together, and that's pretty
well, knowing you, the studio and the garden, maybe.
Yeah, well, the winter's coming, so, you know.
Well, that's good point.
Snow shovel paintings.
Sure. And Gary, how about yourself?
Well, I actually have 3 more exhibitions coming up, 1 in December and 2 in January, so it's back to the studio, which I have a brand new studio, which is working well for me and creating this new work, which I have a lot of energy to continue exploring.
Oh, great. Great. Before we go, I wanted to get both of your take on the Minnesota Artists Exhibition Program. What's it meant for you guys? What do you think of its place here in Minneapolis?
Well, I think it's obviously for us, we're very appreciative of the opportunity to have a completely different audience than normally we would touch. I mean, in the commercial galleries, you're dealing with basically artists and a few collectors, that's about it. But here we have, I like the idea of having young children to older people seeing the work and the exposure, not only in the mailing list, but just who walks through, that they've been wonderful in support of us and putting up the show. It's been a great experience.
Yeah, Brian?
Yeah, I agree with all that, and I think it's important to remember that this program is very unique in the country, really. There really isn't anything like this in what would be considered a major institution, so I really think it's valuable for that. And in an economic climate where gallery commercial spaces are shrinking, so essentially access for contemporary artists is really limited, I think something like this is just incredible. So.
Well, I want to thank both of you for your time and your artwork. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thanks.
And we'll be taking a look at a few more pieces here. There's a lot more to see, so if you haven't seen it all on Artifacts, make sure you come down to the Institute of Arts through the middle of October and see this particular exhibition at the Minnesota Artists Exhibition Program. With National Arts and Humanities Month, we thought we'd put that particular factoid up for your digestion, so enjoy that. Now, later on, we're going to be talking with Susan Gross about an upcoming exhibit, a multidisciplinary exhibit about girls and girlhood that's going to happen at Dayton's downtown Minneapolis later, and that's a very interesting discussion, so stay tuned for that. But first, I have been aware of an upcoming conference with the Minnesota Association of Community Theaters for months and months and months. It's been long in the planning, and it's soon to be here, the end of this month, actually. And I'd like to introduce Pat Slater-Edwards from Lakeshore Players Theater up in White Bear Lake.
Right.
And Donna Norberg, who is the president of the Minnesota Association of Community Theaters. So when you're reading MACT, obviously that's what it means. Welcome to you both. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for inviting us.
Oh, sure. Now, you really have been planning this, and it's a big deal. I mean, you've got people coming from all over. Let's just start out with the who, the what, the when, and the where, and all that kind of stuff. What is this conference and what's it all about?
This is going to be a three-day, a theater festival. I wish I could start over with this, but it's going to be a three-day theater conference that's going to take place in Minneapolis. And this is a seven-state regional event. The seven states that are a part of this, a part of the American Association of Community Theaters Region 5 conference, are Missouri, Nebraska, North Dakota, South Dakota, Kansas, Iowa, Minnesota, and did I get them all?
I wasn't even counting. But in other words, it's the upper Midwest, and they're all coming here to Minneapolis. Your headquarters hotel is in Minneapolis, right?
We're coming together at the Park Inn, and okay. We're going to spend Friday, Saturday, and Sunday there. We've got all sorts of events planned, and if anybody wants to participate, they can certainly call a couple of phone numbers and get the information and come. We still have some spaces available.
Okay, so as people are watching this show, which your conference is at the end of October.
It's at the end of October, right. October 28th, 29th, and 30th.
Okay, and lots of fun things. Obviously there are plays that people will choose to go to, but you also have workshops, so it's a working session here.
We do. We've got 8 workshops. We've got 9 theater events that people can go to. Yeah. They only get to pick 3.
Right.
One on Friday night, one Saturday afternoon, and then one on Saturday evening. But really, people are going to be able to see the best of the Minneapolis downtown theater district. And the 8 workshops that we have will start on, that's going to kick off the event, and that'll be Friday at the Guthrie Theater. We've got a couple of Guthrie people. Rosie Graham, who's going to do a workshop on soft props, and then we also have Michael James and he will do something on set planning. If you want to do a musical, you need to have 8 sets on stage at the same time. How do you organize that? How do you plot it out?
It's
organization and management is what the title of the workshop is.
You know, as long as we mention that there are numbers that people can call, let's test your memory. We can put them up on the screen so that people know what they are. But if people wanted to call for more information about either MACT or the conference, what are those numbers?
Sure. One of the things that MACT has is a hotline, which is soon to go statewide. And the number for our hotline is 521-5692. The number for the conference is 884-9676. You can get information on the conference either way.
And as I understand, that one on the conference, something I read said, call in the evenings.
So, well, that would be good, but there's an answering service.
So a guy named Steve is going to be real happy with all these evening calls. So
guy named Bill.
Guy named Bill, all right. Well, that was a lucky guess. It sounds good, and you've got a big keynote address happening on, what is it, the Friday, I think?
Right. This is something that I would really like to invite everybody to because it's open to the public, and it's free. Mm-hmm. And we've got John Kalacki, who is the curator of the performing arts at the Walker Arts Center. He's going to be talking about planning an organization also, only this is more on a funding level. He's been doing a lot of work as a consultant with East European and Central European theater and performing arts groups, and he has some things that he wants to share with us about his experience.
John was a guest on this show about a year ago, and he said that in some of his travels, it's a real eye-opener to find out just some of the constraints and some of the issues and the not-so-happy experiences that theater companies and communities go through around the world compared to what we sort of take for granted here. So it's interesting. And speaking of community groups,
okay.
Pat Slater-Edwards, you're associated with the Lakeshore Players Theater, which is in White Bear Lake. Just give us a little introduction to that. What do you do there? What's your mission with Lakeshore Players?
Well, we just hammered out a mission statement about a year ago. Mainly, we wish to entertain and to give people the opportunity to help entertain or to learn something about theater. We've been in existence for over 42 years, and we're slightly younger than another theater in Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. Which claims to be the oldest theater.
I was just going to mention that, but I think from the way you're speaking, I'll just assume people know what we're
referring
to.
Which other theater we're talking about.
Right, so you're both venerable organizations.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah. And where are you now, physically? I mean, specifically, where could someone come to see the Lakeshore?
We're on 6th and Stuart Streets in White Bear Lake. It's an old Baptist church that we've turned into a delightful, very homey little theater. Mm-hmm. We hold almost 200 people. Some of the seats are not that great, and so we sell those at a discount.
Okay, so 200 until the chairs fall.
Right. Or when we're doing a musical, as we're doing right now. Well, we're doing it when we're taping this.
Oh, I see. So
then we have an orchestra, which takes up part of our seating space. And so then we go down to about 170-some people who we can see.
Sounds like a nice house.
Oh, it is nice. Yeah. We do 6 shows a year. And we're especially thrilled with MACT because we won at the last MAC Festival, shared first place when we had a festival, which is sort of like a contest, but we're not supposed to emphasize that. And went on to the regional festival and won 3rd place there, too. So
congratulations.
It was,
so they're evaluated, though, in
yes,
any case.
And yes.
You know,
mm-hmm.
And Pat was directing.
And you directed that. Well, yes. Congratulations, particularly.
Thank you.
Excellent. Well, now that's a good question to lead into. You're obviously very involved with your particular theater, and obviously you're a member of the Minnesota Association of Community Theaters. What has that meant? What does MACT do for you? Or maybe it goes the other way. What do you do for MACT?
I think that MACT has, well, we've been on the map, but they've helped to put us more on the map. I think they do have the hotline, and we do use it for all our auditions and other kinds of announcements that we have. It brings people to Lakeshore mm-hmm. who may not have gotten there before if they hadn't read about us in our wonderful MACT newsletter.
Sure.
For me, personally, I've traveled down to the National Festival because I know people on the MACT. Well, actually, I served on the board for a while, too. Mm-hmm. But it's made me become more aware of the whole national scene in community theater, having participated in the MACT Festival.
And it sounds like there's great value in these conferences and, obviously, from an artistic point of view, the festivals as well.
Oh,
Yeah.
Yes, yes. Learn very interesting things. We just had MAC just sponsored a workshop at Lakeshore last Saturday, in which we had three wonderful workshops, very well attended and very educational. Learned about theater management, about scene painting, very new ideas in scene painting. Yeah. And also
improvisation.
Improvisation, yes. Right.
And this was out at your space?
Right.
Am I right about that? Okay, mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so MAC obviously provides a wide array of assistance or information.
Oh, definitely.
To groups. Now, this show is seen in the metropolitan Twin Cities area, but MAC is statewide. And I talked with, I think he's the editor of your newsletter, about what is this current state of community theater throughout Minnesota. And he surprised me. There are over 200 theaters known as community theaters. Now, we're not talking about professional or some of the large roadhouses like the State or the Orpheum. Mm-hmm. That's quite a lot throughout this state. What's the condition of community theater throughout Minnesota? What are some of the issues they're facing?
Well, I think community theater is thriving. And in some of the areas that I have been making it a point to travel around for the past 2 years while I've been president, and just to see what's going on out there. It seems like everybody really loves their community theater, and the attendance and everything is absolutely wonderful. I mean, the houses in Minneapolis would cry for that kind of attendance.
Wow.
A lot of the cities that I visited are doing new things, like renovating old theater spaces on their downtown Main Street.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, I was up in Fergus Falls, and they've got a Center for the Performing Arts, and they're still fundraising to put this together. But it's going to be wonderful, and it's also going to be part of, I'm sure, an economic revival of their downtown.
Because mm-hmm. you're talking about reclaiming the old theater, whether it was an old vaudevillian theater or perhaps an old movie theater, whatever, and reopening that, usually
right.
on Main Street or close thereby.
Right.
Sure.
They've had a $1 million fundraising event going on. They've raised $700,000 of that so far. Wow. And they are doing a beautiful job.
Close to it, yeah. We've only got a couple more minutes, believe it or not. And I want to talk a little bit about funding and how community theater, in this state anyhow, is supported. It must be a struggle. I mean, it's a struggle for any art form or individual artist. How is it? How is it for Lakeshore? And
it has been very good for us in the past. We've had very good season ticket base, and we've always been able to pay our own way. However, I think things are somewhat changing. We think that we're going to have to start applying for grants and some things to give us a little extra push. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of our older audience who are getting too old, and we're trying to recruit new people and interest new people, but I think the audiences are down all over. Mm-hmm. And so I think we're going to be needing some help, too. We're going to try applying for grants. We did actually get one grant last year.
Okay, so that's sort of a new arena for you.
Yes, right.
And I think everybody, all the theaters need money right now. What I've noticed happening out there in outstate Minnesota is a lot of groups are forming alliances, like Alexandria's got Quad Arts. That's mm-hmm. just one example. And they're doing that so that their their base is larger, so that they can ask for bigger monies, perhaps from Minnesota State Arts Board, etc. I'm wondering at this point in time. I noticed that in '93, for the '93-'94 appropriations, that the Minnesota State Arts Board got an increase of $4.6 million over the '92-'93 mm-hmm. year, and I haven't seen it trickling out into outstate Minnesota. I'm not sure I've even seen it in the metropolitan area.
Mm-hmm. Now, you mean particularly within the community theater
right.
arena.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, it'd be an interesting question to get answered. Yeah. Okay. So, hopeful?
Oh,
things
always.
Always. Indefatigable. Donna Norberg right here.
But I want everybody to come see John Kalacki
okay.
on Friday, October 28th, 3 o'clock. In the Guthrie Auditorium.
Okay, come
just
one,
walk
come
in.
All. They've got over 1,400 seats in that renovated
right.
space right there.
1,441.
Okay.
We need to fill them.
Fill those seats. And not incidentally, check out Lakeshore Players up in White Bear.
Oh, yes.
White Bear Lake, okay. Well, I want to thank you both for coming on and previewing, if you will, this great event, your conference. Best of luck to you, and I hope everybody does make an effort and get over there and hear John and maybe take part in some of the workshops.
Thanks for inviting us.
Okay, Pat, thanks.
Thank you.
Donna, nice to see you again. Okay. Now, we'll be back in just a moment with Susan Gross to talk about a very interesting multidisciplinary exhibit that's going to happen at Dayton's, downtown Minneapolis, called Girls and Girlhood, A Perilous Adventure, A Perilous Path, I'm sorry. Now, in order to lead into that, she was kind enough to provide us with a tape that was produced, and I found it was a charming tape, and it deals a little bit with the issues that underlie this exhibit. So let's take a look at that, and then we'll be back, and we'll talk a little bit about what it raises.
Listen to the children in school.
Like a diamond in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, little star. How I wonder what you are. Up above the world so high. Like a diamond in the sky.
Now, children, I'll read you a story. Many years ago, there lived a king and a queen.
Well, and I must say, I was actually very charmed by that animation. But it also talks about some serious issues. And the issue that it talks about has to do with girls and girlhood. And with me is Susan Gross, who is the executive director of the Upper Midwest Women's History Center. Which is headquartered over at Hamline University, around the grounds.
Yes.
So, Susan, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
And I don't know how we first connected on this. I think some months ago you either called or sent me some information.
Might be.
Yeah. Fascinating. Multidimensional exhibit, international in scope. Why don't you just walk us through some of the basics?
All right. I'll tell you a little bit about it. This exhibit really came out of the UN Summit on Children in 1990. And they decided after that that summit that one of the issues that really hadn't been discussed was differences between the treatment of girls and boys worldwide. And UNICEF, the United Nations Children's Fund, put this exhibit together so that it could bring up some of the issues to do with girls and girlhood. And as you know, it's called Girls and Girlhood, A Perilous Path. You might be interested that it was at the UN Plaza for a few months and then moved to the World Trade Center, and we're the first group to have it out of the state of New York. So it's very exciting. We've been working a whole year to get ready for it, and there will be lots of ancillary events around it. We are very excited that it will be at Dayton's in Minneapolis. They have been very generous with their help all year long with their advice and so forth. And so they will have it in the 12th floor gallery. It's the smaller space right across from the Sky Room. It will be there for a whole month, and it will be open pretty much store hours. There's some special times in the morning for special groups that can call and get a number from me about that. But mostly it will be open every day, at least part of the day. And I think it's going to be extremely exciting to have
it here.
Okay,
well, I think we're going to take a look right now as we speak at the poster. And there's a story behind that. You said there was great cooperation in producing that as well.
That's right. One of the most wonderful things about working on this exhibit, Phil, has been that people... The other day, I just sat down and figured out the amount of dollar amount of time and so forth that people have given really directly, not even our volunteers that have come to meetings, but people who have given of their time, and it's over $100,000 worth of various kinds of in-kind contribution. One of them is this poster that advertises, really promotes the exhibit. And it just says the dates, which are October 15th to November 12th, and gives Dayton's a 12th floor gallery as the place. This was contributed by an Alex Syme, an artist here in Minneapolis, and his mother took those photographs. And each photograph represents a child from a different world area, as you can kind of see. The lower child was taken at Tiananmen Square in China. The middle child is from India, and the upper child is an American Indian child from New Mexico. And we think it's a very wonderful and interesting poster.
It is. Now, right next to that, we've also put up for viewing a very powerful mm-hmm. image and a powerful message. Mm-hmm. Can you share a little bit about
Certainly.
That?
Certainly. I think one of the really exciting things about this exhibit, and it is an international exhibit, including examples from the United States, but from all over the world, is that it traces a girl's growing up. And then it ends on a note of what we call chalking up victories, meaning interventions that are being taken to improve the lives of girls internationally. And this poster represents one of those interventions, because this was a contest done in India about 10 years ago now, to come up with some public way of encouraging, valuing girls as much as sons, valuing daughters as much as sons are in India. And as you can see, the big message is your daughter will never be as good as your son unless you give her a chance. And this really fits into the idea of encouraging girls' education too. You may know that for people over 15, two-thirds of the world's illiterates are women.
I was unaware of that. That's quite an imbalance.
It really is an imbalance. And what governments such as India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Latin American countries have done is to really, the last 10 years, encourage women's education. Countries in Africa, the same way. And so that the statistics are quite encouraging. It's getting quite
so
exciting.
Those positive things.
That's
well,
right.
I know, too, that nutrition and medical care are also big issues for girls around
That's
the world
right.
Well.
Yeah. And statistically, girls are often taken to clinics later than boys are. They may be taken, but they're sicker when they go. They often, in many cultures, we might have even laughed about this, but that women do eat last and girls eat last, mm-hmm. and that implies sure. that if there's something to
it's
eat.
More than a stereotype.
That's right, yeah. exactly. And all those customs, I think, are falling. They're being examined. They're being looked at by governments. I think one of the really exciting things that's happened is that India and other countries in South Asia, Bangladesh and Sri Lanka and others, declared 1990 the year of the girl child and then extended that for the decade of the girl child. And now the United States has finally got a resolution in front of our Congress that will declare the rest of the years of this decade the years of the girl child. So we're coming, we're following their lead. Yeah. And this is happening all over the world, is that many parts of the world are coming up with wonderful solutions to problems for women and girls.
Well, Susan, let's talk a little bit about the specific
the
exhibit and some of the related events.
Fine.
A lot of names known to Minnesotans are going to be part of it. You've got a benefit, as I recall, Ann Reed, Minnesota.
That's right.
Songwriters.
We have a very exciting benefit. The exhibit is free and open to the public, but we are before the exhibit opens on October 15th, the evening before October on October 14th, we're having a benefit for the exhibit, and those tickets are available through me again.
We'll get that number up on the
yeah,
screen
right.
before we're done.
Good.
Yeah.
And Ann Reed came to us. Ann Reed, the folk singer and very well known in Minnesota, but really throughout the United States and beyond, came to us and said, I would like to do this for you, and I will donate all of the revenue to the exhibit. So that was really a high. We had been turned down, as people are, yeah. for funding. And this was a very, very
crucial
and oh. very wonderful thing. So that will be an exciting event. Tommy DiPaolo, who is one of the people whose works are in the exhibit, will be there.
Let me interrupt you, if I may.
Certainly.
We can refer to one of the books, The Legend of the
Bluebonnet.
Yeah.
Yes, and I should probably quickly explain that each of these five stages of a girl's growing up are introduced using a piece of children's literature. And so one of the stages, girlhood, is introduced using The Legend of Bluebonnet, which is this legend of Texas.
Sure.
And another one is, and Tommy DiPaolo will be at the benefit.
Right,
that's
course,
right.
For many of our viewers, they're familiar with his collaboration with the Children's
Theater
Company.
In the
Children's
Theater and this kind of thing. The other person we're very, very excited about is Faith Ringgold.
Yes.
Faith Ringgold wrote maybe her most famous book, although she's written others, is Tar Beach. And that's the one that also is in the exhibit. And you may remember the story is of a young woman who learns to fly,
yes,
and then finally brings her brother along.
Right. And she,
so it's a lovely image for girls, I think.
Person.
She is going to be here for 2 days. We're
That's
just
great.
Thrilled.
That's
She's speaking great. At the Walker Gallery, mm-hmm. Walker Art Center, and on her work, which is in the Guggenheim. And she only comes where her work is shown. And I understand gets many phone calls every single day of
the only place
of
I've ever seen her work was in Atlanta, so I'm glad to know that it's happening here.
Well,
that's
it's
good.
Just amazing that we got her.
That's great.
And a woman named Pam Holt from the Minneapolis, from the Hennepin County Libraries was the instrumental in making sure that that happened.
And you have events going on, as you told me,
all over the
yeah.
time. There's some lectures at Hamlin that are going to be very exciting. Leslie Wolf from Washington, D.C., and Neera Sahoni from Stanford are speaking on the girl child, and very, very interesting people. So I hope people will call me for a calendar.
And I'm wondering, maybe I neglected to mention this, but this is a multidisciplinary exhibit. We've mentioned obviously the book illustrators, but it
right.
includes painting,
right.
set design, or
set
scenery?
Design. There, I've got wonderful pictures of young children talking and holding yeah. onto the sets. You know, I mean it's very colorful and very serious both.
Right.
It brings up some very crucial things for young girls mm-hmm. all over the world and yeah. in the United States. But it's colorful enough, I think, to be attractive to very young children. And thoughtful enough to right. be interesting to whole families.
Well, and from
the
clip that we're showing, obviously the videos involved, there's photography, there's storytelling.
Right, right. Well, and exactly. It's
Before we go on too long here, what is the number, Susan, people could call if they want to find
right.
out more about any one or all of these events?
Our number at the Women's History Center is 644-1727.
Okay, so they should call that.
644-1727.
Find out not only about mm-hmm. your organization maybe a little bit, but certainly
That's
the
right.
girls and girlhood.
One thing I should mention is that someone came to me and said, you know, you have people doing all these things, Faith Ringgold and these people from speaking on the girl child and so forth, but we need something for girls. So the opening day of the exhibit, the 15th, we will have an all-day celebration of Minnesota girls at the Hamlin campus. It's going from 9 in the morning to 4 in the afternoon, and girls are putting everything on. Literally.
Nice.
They are literally putting on the whole day, and we expect about 500 girls at that. And then they will be bused also to the exhibit if they want to go.
I was just going to ask, because that leads the question, then.
That's right.
You want to get busloads of kids.
That's
and
right.
People coming
exactly.
to this. That's great.
Exactly.
So if perhaps a teacher or a school was listening to this show, call
they,
that number.
They and could, and certainly call me, and we would talk about it, and I can give them the scheduling.
So see what arrangements
yes,
can be made.
Yes, there is
that.
A special time for scheduled groups.
Great.
So,
well, Susan, I think we've just about run out of time. I want to urge people to check out the exhibit at Dayton's. Give a call if you couldn't hear everything we're saying about these specific events, but we've got some major people coming in to share their feelings and their commitment.
Yes.
So, Susan, thank you so much.
Thank you.
It's great to have you here.
Nice to be here.
Well, and we're going to leave this segment with another view of that particular animation that we started out with. So let's take one more look at that, and then Janet will be back, and we have a few more things to say at the end of the show.
Many years ago, there lived a king and a queen. They were very happy, except for one thing. They had two sons, but they longed for a daughter. One night, there was a big storm. A little girl came to the gate of the palace and shouted, "Let me in!" What did she shout?
"Let me in!"
"Hey, it's a planet!
learn it too? Do you want to learn too? I'll be the teacher.
And once again, that was a portion of a piece from the Girls and Girlhood, a Perilous Path exhibit that's coming up later this month at Dayton. So I really urge you to go and see that. Sounds like a great event. And next month, very exciting.
Yes, I am really excited about this.
We're going to go on location, the two of us, to see the Minneapolis Community College Gospel Choir in rehearsal. I mean, they're hot. If you haven't seen them, tune in, see them here. They're hot.
But the best thing is Phil is going to sing. It's going to be great.
When I sing, birds leave the neighborhood.
Well, I'm hoping. We've got a lot of film and video activity going on in the fall here in Minneapolis. So I'm sure we're going to have something quite
It's the busy season, so we're going to try and cover it for you here on Artifacts. And mm-hmm. do stay tuned, because just right now, we're going to give you an events calendar.
Yeah, thanks for watching.
Yeah, I'm Phil Lindsay.
I'm Janet Zahn.
See you next time.
Good.
We had a great segment.
Thank you.
Yeah, they were good guests in that animation.
Wasn't incredible. The animation wonderful?
Yeah.
God,
I'll pat
amazed.
Your back if you pat me.
Well, yeah, and of course, yeah. You did a wonderful job.
Well, and you got your leg crossed again. Janet, I just have to compliment you. I finally figured out, I was watching that first segment, yeah. I was out at the monitor, yeah. And I was figuring out it's October.
Yeah.
And I know what your color scheme is.
That's
it's
true.
Orange and black.
That's true.
That is so clever of you.
I actually totally planned.
Did you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Woke up, said.
October show.
TV show.
Mm-hmm.
Wardrobe.